Well, hello, welcome to Critical Thinking in the Classroom, Part 1. So I want to begin this session today by asking you to first take a moment and think about your favorite sport, okay? Now imagine that what would happen if we were to strip away, right, some of the main components of sports. So for example, let's suppose that we removed any feedback, right? So there'd be no scoreboard, to be able to monitor how you're doing. And let's suppose also that we remove universal rules, right? One of the things that tends to be an issue for sports is that the rules are the same, right? If you play basketball in California, you can play basketball in Missouri or Texas. Very little rule changes depending upon where you're at. And let's suppose that we take away competition, right? If you can't keep score and the rules are not universal, right, then that would prohibit any two people or in two teams from being able to compete with one another, okay? So we've stripped all those away from your favorite sport. So what do you have left? Well, the truth is that it would be no fun, right? Most sports, if you remove the things that we just identified, ultimately end up being more tasks than sports. And I want to suggest to you that what I've just described is actually how most students think about academic work, that it's no fun. And the question is, what if we were able to put back these important components? If we were able to put back feedback, universal rules, and competition, I want to suggest to you that that's basically the territory of critical thinking. This is what critical thinking does for us, I think, in academic work. It creates an opportunity, it creates a mechanism for feedback, it creates universal rules. Most students are always sort of thrown aback when I suggest to them that there actually are universal rules to thinking. And just like sports, if you learn those rules, right, you can compete with respect to that kind of thinking module. So I think this is what critical thinking does for us, is that it provides feedback, it provides universal rules, and because of that, right, there can be competition. Now, this need not necessarily be competition between teams or individuals. It can be a competition with oneself, right, as a way of monitoring progress in terms of your ability to think. Now, any session always has to begin with what I would consider to be the requisite definition. So I'm going to flash some definitions here with respect to critical thinking, definitions that are fairly standard in the field. But what I'm not going to do is actually kind of read these to you. By the way, those are handout in which you can actually download and you'll have all these definitions. Instead, I want to suggest to you a definition that I've been working around with that I think kind of nicely captures the complexity of all of these definitions. So it's kind of my definition. And that is that critical thinking is basically thinking about your thinking while you are thinking, okay? Simple enough, critical thinking is thinking about your thinking while you are thinking. And for me, this definition highlights what I think are the two crucial components of critical thinking, right? One has to do with that it emphasizes the fact that critical thinking is metacognitive. So that's just a big word that we use to really get at the idea that we're self-reflective, right? When you are engaging in metacognitive processes, you are able to step outside of yourself and to observe yourself, right? And so it's thinking about your thinking while you're thinking, right? So that's what you're doing. The other piece here that's more implied, but nonetheless very important to this, is that it's standards-based. Right? So when you're thinking about your thinking, how are you thinking about it? Right? Part of what you're doing is you're comparing your thinking to a group of standards, right? These sort of universal rules that I was hinting at earlier. So for me, these are really the two critical components of critical thinking. Oftentimes, I think students mistake the idea of critical thinking is that it's somehow pessimistic thinking, right? It means to think critical means to engage in doubt, right? That's not really what the term critical means when we talk about critical thinking. It means the ability to engage in metacognition, said another way, meta-reflection. It also means that we are thinking according to certain standards and certain values that govern the way that we are thinking, okay? So what I want to do now is I want to pivot to something that I call the critical thinking map. Some years ago, some colleagues and I got together and really started playing around with what might be a roadmap for critical thinking. And I will say that this has gone through a little bit of evolution since we first established it, but I think it still serves a purpose, and that is to kind of help connect all the things that I'm going to be talking about in this module around critical thinking. The first part of the map really begins with what I call the thinking triggers. In other words, there are opportunities that present themselves for which we might engage in critical thinking. Now, of course, we're presented with the option of not using critical thinking, but nonetheless, they are the opportunities that ought to trigger critical thinking. And what I mean by this is that oftentimes in the work that we do, there's basically three things that we have to do. It either entails listening, writing, or speaking, right? Listening, writing, or speaking, right? So anytime there's a situation in which you have to listen to something, or maybe you're being required or requested to write something or to speak on something, right? This is part of that trigger. The other piece of this actually has to do with the nature of the information that we're going to either be listening to, writing about, or speaking about. And that is that you can pretty much take all information and sort it into three categories. Narrative, which has to do with a story, right? So akin to storytelling. Expository, having to do with the need to explain something. And then an argument, right? An attempt to persuade, if you will, someone with regard to something. So for me, a thinking trigger is anytime we have to listen, write, or speak with respect to some narrative, some expository, or making an argument. So these are the thinking triggers. Now, in order to do this well, we're going to have to develop some cognitive or thinking abilities. And usually those abilities are hierarchical in the sense that they run from fairly simple abilities like remembering and understanding, but then run down to fairly highly more complex forms of thinking, such as the ability to evaluate and create. Now, these cognitive abilities are important abilities to develop if we're going to be better listeners, writers, or speakers, right? We must develop these cognitive abilities. So let me say a little bit more about the cognitive abilities. For those of you who may have had some previous exposure to critical thinking, you might recognize these cognitive abilities, for they come from something called Bloom's taxonomy, and more specifically from a revision of Bloom's taxonomy. This is probably one of the best known cognitive ability taxonomies that's been around. And according to Bloom, there are basically six different cognitive abilities that we must develop. We must have the ability to remember, which Bloom sort of likened to the ability to recognize and recall, understanding, being able to interpret something, the ability to apply what we're learning, the ability to analyze, which has to do with the ability to differentiate and organize things. Evaluation, right, usually involves being able to use certain standards to critique things, and then ultimately the ability to create things. Now, as a teacher, I should tell you that there's actually a lot out there that already talks about the various ways in which we might be able to apply Bloom's taxonomy, or at least the revised taxonomy, to our teaching. Just to flash a few of these things, here's a couple of guides that would walk you through, for example, how you could take each of these six critical thinking skills and begin to kind of either develop in class or out of class kinds of instructions or exercises, as well as assessments based around them. Because these things are already available, I'm actually not going to spend time in this module really talking about these, but I would definitely suggest that you actually do a little bit of searching on the internet for things that are based around Bloom's revised taxonomy. You might find this just as helpful for what it is that you're doing in addition to things that I'm going to do. So once again, because this information is very readily available on the internet, instead, I'm going to talk about some things that perhaps are not as available as Bloom's revised taxonomy. So back to my critical thinking map. One of the things that I think that sometimes we make the mistake of thinking, and that is that just because we are assessing cognitive abilities or we are building it into our work, that somehow in and of itself helps to develop a student's capacity for these abilities. But the reality is that actually just knowing that we need to have these cognitive abilities does not in and of itself develop them, which is why I tend to put a focus on what the third column is in the thinking map, and that is certain tools and strategies that you can use to actually therefore then develop these cognitive abilities. And the tools and strategies are kind of sorted into these same three categories that we use when we talked about the thinking triggers. In other words, I think there are tools and strategies that can be developed with respect to our ability to engage in narrative or storytelling, or for that matter, our ability to understand a certain narrative. There are tools that would help us to engage in expository kinds of learning, or once again, expository teaching. And then there are tools that one could use for being able to make a logical and sound argument. So in the remaining modules, I'm going to be kind of introducing tools under each of these umbrellas, some tools that speak to the narrative storytelling, some tools that help us with our ability to engage in expository learning, and then some tools that'll help us to be able to sort of make arguments.